And now we come to our last speaker before the general discussion. So Keith Comito from the Transhumanist Party.
All right, can you see my slides?
Yes.
Yep. All right, so as introduced, I'm Keith Comito, president of the nonprofit Life Extension Advocacy Foundation, actually, or lifespan.io, which raises funds and awareness for life extension research. I believe most of you know who I am, so I'll proceed. Firstly, thank you for inviting me to speak at this excellent event. I'm happy to be here, especially today, the UN International Day of Older Persons, a perfect occasion to reflect on how addressing aging will serve to protect the older among us, especially in these times and everyone in general. In this presentation, I'm going to talk about some issues inhibiting biomarkers of aging, achieving large-scale utility and adoption, how we might take some lessons from other fields to overcome them and potentially create a path to selling the public, investors, and policymakers on the value of aging research more generally and hasten the development of the field. So in that case, the latter parts of my talk, David actually teed up wonderfully. So when we get there, you'll see. But firstly, to begin, as we all know, technology has been rapidly developing that is allowing us to generate and collect various forms of biomarker data, even passively as we go about our daily lives through devices like mobile phones, sleep and activity trackers, et cetera. And this data is already being used in various clinical trials and, along with other types of medical data, is starting to be integrated into emerging healthcare data commons platforms such as the NIH's All of Us initiative and the UK Biobank. And this naturally begs the question of whether a reliable system of aging biomarkers can be applied to data sets like this and become part of basically every trial to always have that secondary indication of how an intervention is affecting the aging process. And over the past few years, there has been a large number of age-focused healthcare products and online data systems emerging, aiming to use various biomarkers to illustrate their efficacy. But one of the main problems thus far has been that everyone's doing their own thing, using different data sets of biomarkers for testing similar interventions and or formatting their data in a proprietary way that doesn't interoperate with other systems. And this siloing of data, fragmentation of analysis methods, and lack of clarity on which biomarkers to use how and in what combinations creates a scenario that slows progress in comparison to one where everyone is operating within a standardized goal-oriented framework. And this state of affairs indicates that we might be able to apply a lesson from the history of another field with what we might actually need right now being a grand standardization initiative with authority and funding at the national or international level, like Didier was just speaking about, similar to what happened with the birth of the internet after the creation of the ARPANET in the 70s. This basically took the form of international councils set up to agree upon a set of protocols and standards so that everyone's work could interoperate. And this resulted in the backbone for protocols like TCP and HTTP, which are still used today and part of the infrastructure that's allowing us to communicate here right now. And importantly, analogous standards for health data like FHIR or Fast Healthcare Interoperability Resource are emerging now and starting to be integrated into ubiquitous technologies like smartphones, part of Apple's health kit, for example. And thus, now is the time to perhaps push for a similar grand initiative formed to select biomarker targets and interoperability standards so that the entire field can work together as we're working on our individual projects, studies, and companies, et cetera. Now, this is usually the part where statements like biology is not the same as software are made, and that is totally valid. And this is why it's important to note that the standardization we're talking about here doesn't mean standardization of the tests themselves, but rather of the format of the data that results from these tests, as well as in the process of how analysis and meta-analysis is conducted across various data sets. For example, simplified, let's say this hypothetical council is first able to agree upon some desired metric for biological age that, if you know, magically achieved, would be unequivocally useful as a diagnostic to detect rate of aging throughout any clinical trial, specifically aging focused or otherwise. Say, for instance, a property of this is that it will be testable by being able to predict the chronological age of a normal person not undergoing any specific intervention, with a mean absolute error of less than X, with the X years, with a correlation above Y, et cetera, whatever that is, whatever is deemed to be universally useful. Then, once that is determined, the requirements of how this goal could be achieved can be worked backwards from. Which types of biomarkers with which properties we think, you know, cover each other's weaknesses that we think are minimally necessary so that a composite metric based upon them will fulfill the desired properties of the goal metric. And it's important to note that this can be mathed out to some degree. Whether every biomarker potentially contributing to this is actually real or implemented yet or not. And then we can further work backwards to determine subcomponents in a similar process, creating a network of interrelations that were, I think Aubrey was talking about earlier. Solutions can then be analyzed by the council and debated upon with respect to considerations like Aubrey talked about, overfitting, et cetera, to determine which paths are the most feasible in the near term with the fewest amount of currently unrealized holes in biomarkers, what those holes are, creating essentially a scaffold that allows fulfillment of the true initial goal to be distributed and worked on by everybody, component-wise. Because we're all building individual projects to fit into the same overall spec and generating interoperable data while we're doing whatever else we're doing. Furthermore, because it is the goal that we're standardizing to, not the exact way in which we get there, this allows for iteration and flexibility regarding which tests and analysis methods are appropriate for which circumstances. For example, if we have a trial where we're collecting stool samples and blood samples, you know, this combination of 10 will eventually decide will be the best route to the goal. Or what if we're doing a crowdsourced trial and all we can get is physiological biomarker data? You know, what configuration of those markers and analysis methods to use in that scenario would fulfill the goal to the best of that ability? Now, if this seems a bit abstract or unrealistic, allow me to illustrate an analogous example involving data from technology you likely use all the time, video streaming platforms. With such systems, it's common for a company to want to predict things like a user's likelihood of staying with the service year after year, and to determine the most useful combination of contributing metrics that can be measured right now that accurately represent this future behavior. Furthermore, this process can be iterated upon as with each year you can check it. The accuracy of various approaches and combinations can be validated to see which ones, which markers, and what combinations led to the most accurate predictions and thus identify the most impactful targets for intervention. For example, let's say a higher number of sub-profiles on an account that also uses party mode frequently greatly contributes to user retention, then it'll be smart for the service to work on interventions that promote use of party mode amongst multiple profiles on an account if they want more user retention. And now it's important to note that this isn't really just an analogy. Some of these measures are actually biomarkers, such as decision-making speed. And this is gathered typically longitudinally, sometimes on a daily basis from millions of people. So this ties into the second main point I want to make, and which David was alluding to, the opportunity to use physiological biomarkers as a key of sorts to convince and excite the public regarding the value of biomarkers in aging research generally. As mentioned, ubiquitous devices like smartphones are already collecting a variety of biomarker data, and many have built-in diagnostics and frameworks like the research kit we mentioned, which facilitate the usage of this data in clinical trials. And online, people frequently submit data, like with FaceApp, that could be repurposed towards relevant ends, such as training facial biomarkers of aging. And this sort of physiological biomarker data will only become more regularly collected on a massive scale as technologies like voice recognition, augmented reality, and gesture tracking become part of those ubiquitous platforms, such as the streaming services, you know, visual reaction time, tremor detection, etc. And this allows opportunities to really do something significant with just physiological data that can not only be useful, but also build significant public pressure for age-related biomarkers. As an example, what if it turned out that a marker related to aging, such as slowed reaction time, was an early symptom of COVID-19, which could be detected by the aforementioned platforms at a population level, you know, a large percentage of people in a certain city, for example, you'd have potentially an early warning system. And you could imagine the headlines, you know, your Netflix queue could save your life, et cetera. And how this could naturally build demand for data to be used this way and facilitate crowdsourced clinical trials, creating natural collaboration paths between the public, government, and large recognizable companies that can serve as powerful social signals. Now, of course, as mentioned, to do this right, there are related issues regarding data security and privacy that would need to be sufficiently addressed to make everyone feel comfortable. And they can be, and certain countries are already implementing interesting ways to do this with technologies such as blockchain, et cetera, but that's a separate topic. And to return to that hypothetical example, it also illustrates another knock-on benefit of creating the scaffold that we discussed earlier. It allows non-obvious stakeholders to see how they can be involved once such an initiative is created. For example, certain companies in the entertainment industry already have capabilities to gather specific types of physiological biomarker that surpass those of any current biotech company. And this would allow them to say, hey, that component, we can do that, and receive a related grant or inducement prize from the grand initiative's funding pool allocated to this, and or, you know, the PR benefits of helping to save lives. And this power to engage a variety of stakeholders is why I strongly feel having a grand government-led initiative to do something like this is a key plank of fulfilling the promise of the longevity dividend, which we spoke about earlier, and a topic which I spoke about more fully at the Ending Age-Related Diseases conference a few months ago, and you can find that video on our YouTube if you're interested. But in conclusion, a potential strategy to drive the development of aging biomarkers quickly may be to apply a similar data standardization approach that helped birth the internet ourselves as a community with physiological biomarkers, and think of ways to partner with high-profile entities, like David was talking about, to positively shock the public on the value of biomarkers generally, which can allow us to build momentum towards a large, grand initiative, which can in turn help us do this for all aging biomarkers, driving forward our field and enabling the potential for new types of crowdsourced clinical trials, which can not only allow more stakeholders to explore therapies lacking traditional profit motives, but also create pressure on the existing system to evolve. In this way, employing a model of standardization and interoperability for physiological biomarkers, similar to those that are already being employed on analogous data sets, can serve as a key to unlocking the longevity dividend and help propel us forward to a world free from the diseases of aging. Thank you for your time and attention. And I believe everyone here is familiar with what we do at lifespan.io, but if you'd like more information or to help us, here's that information, and you can contact me as well. Thank you.
Thanks, Keith. Also being so very punctual. So there are two questions. Have you considered, one's from Anton Kulaga, have you considered about standardization of benchmarks for measuring accuracy and other metrics of biomarkers, as well as distributed data set for cross-validation biomarkers predicting models?
Yes, absolutely. The case that I'm walking through here is kind of a simplified case in that slide that kind of had the, you know, network of everything talking to each other. You would want to have systems like that to basically cross-reference all the biomarkers with each other in interrelationships. And basically, the key there is that that guideline or standardization system isn't really just one monolithic thing. That's not what the council would decide upon. It's really a hypothesized system of mathematical equations that sort of relate them in relationships that then can be tested. So that's why I mentioned the point of, at the end, this isn't really what we want as per the earlier conversation, but it should be a property of a marker suite like this, that it should be able to accurately predict the chronological age of a non-intervened person, right? So that's not really what you're going for the interventions, but it should be a validator. And then you can see and iterate on the system. Okay, this configuration with these biomarkers seem to be more accurate than those. This configuration of biomarkers, the same configuration with different data sets, this data set seemed to work better than those. Is that because there's something wrong in our system, or because there was something lacking in that data set, et cetera? So it's a very, you know, complicated mathematical mesh. But my point is, we should set up a scaffold so that we have a place to start and iterate. And that's a process that I can't speak, you know, without getting in trouble, but it's a process that I participate in to some degree in my other life. And I know that it's possible for very analogous data sets.
Okay, thanks a lot. And one short last question from Attila. Which existing organization do you think is closest to embody implement your approach?
To be honest, I haven't really done like a full audit of everyone who's working in the space, because as mentioned, there are a lot, especially in the last couple of years, which is a good sign. But I will say, you know, to call out some of the earlier talks, Alex Zabranka, for example, was illustrating sort of a case of this, of relating different biomarkers to each other, testing them, putting them in the suite, developing, you know, an aggregate clock. So certainly that type of work is moving in this direction.